Welcome to Comrade Media's cultural series In Pursuit of Roots. Now we are going to see and hear the fifth episode, that is Topography of Ancient Tamilagam. Topography of Ancient Tamilagam is the title of the episode. It of course includes Kerala also. This matter our beloved Dr. Mohan Varghese gave details in the previous episode. Let us now hear what he has to say, or the enlightening, informative words of this man of great knowledge. Let us hear it. Sir, please start the...
Very much, yeah.
We can start.
What would you want about the topography?
Topography of the ancient Tamilagam, including Kerala.
Kerala definitely was a part of ancient Tamilagam. Although we never used to say Kerala, we have seen earlier that we never used to say Kerala. And topographically, the entire Tamilagam, which is spread in today's Tamil Nadu and Kerala.
Karnataka,
southern part. Not exactly Karnataka, but only the southern part.
Southern part only.
Entire Kerala, entire present day Tamil Nadu, and some part of Karnataka, of course. So that was the ancient Tamilagam. And today's area of discussion is
area
topography.
Of discussion.
The western cuts, that is the hills of Kerala Tamil Nadu border. Now, actually, vertically divides the entire Tamilagam. Entire Tamilagam. On the left side, that is the western side of western cuts, is Kerala.
Western cut. Like Kerala.
Which is a slender piece of land. It was only the slope, the mountain slope. And ancient Kerala never had much of a plain land either. But the other side, the eastern side of the western cuts, the present day Tamil Nadu, had plenty of land.
It was comparatively wide than the
Much
other.
Wider. Three or four times wider than the ancient Kerala part. So this area has conventionally been divided into Tinai. That is based on land.
So Tina, what is the correct meaning of Tina?
Tina is the land pattern. In Sankham literature, they talk about Tina. Ayin Tinai. Five different unique identifiable land pattern is
five called Tinas.
Ayind means
Ayind
five.
Five
Tinas. It is based on the altitude of the land and where exactly the land is located. The highest hills, the peak, is called Kurunjinilam.
Kurunjinilam. And outer high ranges.
It's high range, steep hills. Extreme hills, hilly areas like
that area Munnar. Belongs to that Tina?
It belongs to the Tina. Munnar, present day Munnar. That is where Kurunji flowers are seen.
Nila Kurunji.
So that is top hills. Not just Munnar, it can be Anamalai.
Panmudi.
And all these areas are Kurunji. And also Wayanadan hills can be Kurunji. Kurunji Nilam. That is known after flower. Kurunji is a flower. And then comes a bit of a low hills, not exactly high hills, medium range hills, coming down westwards. That can be called the Mullai Nilam.
Mullai Nilam.
Mullai also is a flower.
Mullai actually...
Jasmine.
Our jasmine is...
Low jasmine, yeah. Mullai Nilam.
Mullai
Nilam is on the other side also. Kurunji could be common with Kerala and Tamil Nadu, the present day Kerala and Tamil Nadu at top. And on either side, there is a longer Mullai in Kerala side and Shatta Mullai in Tamil Nadu side. But when it comes to the third land, that is called the Marudam.
Marudam.
Marudanilam.
Marudanilam.
Marudanilam is the river bed, leveled land.
Comparatively lower.
Comparatively lower, the lower. Lowest. Very low. Lowest land. Lowest. That is low. That is where the rivers flow. Very fertile land.
Fertile land.
Extremely fertile land. Ideal for cultivation.
Cultivation.
Including paddy cultivation.
Especially paddy.
Especially paddy. There are other crops also. Paddy. Thinna. Thinna is a little more of higher land. But paddy thinna. Is low land.
Low land.
That marshy land. Marshy land. All that. And Tamil Nadu was very rich in maritime. That is the Kaveri Delta. The river Kaveri, the river Vaiga, and all these rivers flow along Tamil Nadu. But Kerala's river those days, the Churniar, that is the present-day Periyar.
Present-day Periyar is known as?
It used to be known as Churniar.
Churniar.
That is because that is where a pearl called Chaurneyam.
Chaurneyam.
Chaurneyam is a very, very costly pearl. Pearl harvesting was one of the major occasions. Valar, there's one community, used to concentrate on pearl harvesting. So that is so the land where the river where Chaurneyam, that is the pearl is called Churniar. Chaurneyam is a very costly pearl. That's called Churniar.
And how this name got derived from there? From Churniar to Periyar.
Periyar. Periyar is just big. Periyar means big. Big river. It originates in the Kurunji. It flows along the Mullai and it comes down to the Maridam and it reaches the Neidal and into the sea.
Covering all these.
Covering parts. All these landscape. The rivers landscape. Flow always from top to down.
Top to down.
Yeah. That is that. These are the see that the fifth area. No, the fourth area in fact is called the Neidal.
Neidal.
Neidal also is Maridam is flower. Neidal also is a kind of flower. Neidal Nilam.
Nilam.
Is the coastal belt, just Arabian coast and the Bay of Bengal coast. Both are Neidal.
Bay of Bengal.
Not only Arabian coast, but the Bay of Bengal coast of the Tamil Nadu. That's also Neidal. Neidal would be equal. See, the coastal belt would be Kerala coast and Tamil Nadu coast, you know. Of course, you know, coastal belt is there. But regarding Maridam, Kerala was unfortunate. We didn't have much of Maridam. Because our rivers were directly flowing and reaching Neidal without going along Maridam. Today we have Maridam. Now we don't call it Maridam. Today we have Pampa river surrounding areas are there. Periyar has got beautiful, you know, landscape around it. In those days, you know, we never had it. So Tamil Nadu had all present day Tamil Nadu, that is the Chola region, Pandya region, was rich in all the four, including Palai. Palai Nilam is actually neither Mulla nor Palai also is Palai is a tree and it flowers also. It's a very it's a seasonal thing. It smells very good.
All these are connected with flowers also.
It's flowers.
Then let me ask one question. What about this any connection with Mulla Periyar?
Yes, it should be Mulla Periyar is Mullai Nilam. This is it flows along Mullai. It originates in Kurunji Nilam in the eastern part of Pathanamthitta district and then it comes along the Idukki district entering into the present day Ernakulam district and into the Arabian Sea via Alve, Ernakulam, that region. Earlier it used to go along the little more north into Muzaris.
Muzaris
is the Kodungallur. That is further north. North of Ernakulam. Definitely north of Ernakulam. So Mulla Periyar is a Periyar that originates in the Kurunji land and flows along the Mullai land is called the Mulla Periyar. And that's where the controversial dam that bone of contention between two Dravidian states, Kerala and Tamil Nadu, that is Mulla Periyar.
So let me ask one question.
Yeah.
Take it as a joke.
Absolutely.
I think Kodungallur or Muzaris is your favorite place. Because in all episodes you have something to say about Kodungallur. Maybe because you once told me it was the second largest city in the whole world. Is it correct, sir?
Being a proud Malayali, being a Keralite, is my pride, is our pride to tell the world that it was arguably the second largest city during the time of the Roman Empire.
Which is first?
first could not be Rome, it could be Alexandria. From trading,
Alexandria. Oh.
From trading parlance,
oh.
right from BC 3rd century into AD 1st century, it should have been ideally Alexandria, which is the trading hub.
So second place comes to our Kodungallur.
If you look at the number of vessels, number of ships coming and anchoring, and quantity of trade and commodities, international trade, then Muziris definitely could be second only to Alexandria.
Okay.
So that was the kind of Roman trade happening 2000 years back. Okay. Roman ships, 50, 60 ships at one stretch would come and graze our land, and they will anchor.
How glorious a proposition we Kerala's had that.
So that is the reason why, no wonder why, I tend to use a little bit of Muziris and Kodungallur, that is present-day Kodungallur, around. Roughly Kodungallur. You can't, you don't even know exact location of Muziris, but it is in the outskirts of Kodungallur.
So this came to be a dreamland.
It's a dreamland, yeah.
Okay, okay.
No wonder God's own country had a beautiful capital.
No.
That is Vanchi, which is situated close to Muchuri. Muchuri Patanam is Muziris.
Sir, may I ask one more question? All the authentic information, from where can we collect it?
We can collect about the Thina, about the rivers, about the life, about the people, all from Sangham literature.
Oh.
It's Sangham, you know. Group.
Again, some doubt remains.
Yep.
I would like to clear all the doubts because
I can ask for the audience, anything. You know, it's
I can ask you anything.
Right, right.
I am also learning.
Right.
You see.
Right.
So I ask this.
Yeah, sure.
What is the meaning of Sangha or Sangha literature? Sangham.
Is a group. The group of
scholars. Also, Sangham team.
Team, a group.
Oh.
There are literary people. From time to time, poetries have been written. Prose have been written. And this poetry is on an empty number of themes.
Themes.
Some are love poems. Some are war-related poems. Some may be about the statecraft, about diplomacy, about eating habits. Food habits,
agriculture, also.
Agriculture,
reaping,
lifestyle,
reaping, sowing,
reaping, sowing, everything.
Oh.
All these things, you know, became the themes of various poets.
Yeah.
And a learned group of scholars, that is called Sangham.
Sangham, learned group,
learned
of,
group of scholars.
Group of scholars.
They are called the Sangham.
Oh.
And there are three Sanghams from time to time. The first Sangham is called Muthal Sangham.
Muthal Sangham.
Muthal means first. First Sangham. Then comes the middle Sangham. That is called Idai Sangham.
Idai.
That's middle. And then comes Kadai Sangham. Kadai is the last.
Kadai is the
in
last.
In Tamil, Kadai is the last. Kadai Sangham, Mudal Sangham, Mudar or Mudal Sangham.
The first one.
Idai Sangham, second one, middle one. And the last one, the Kadai Sangham.
Kadai, what is the meaning of
Kadai? Kadai means last. Last one.
Last.
Okay. That's the final.
So Mudal first, Kadai last. Ida itself is Idail.
So the scholastic works were compiled, collected, compiled, classified, codified, and published by these people. Poets. Poets and artists, you know, all these people, learned ones.
Is it possible for our students, present generation, to refer to the Sangham literature? Where
absolutely
can they find it?
Very much available, published, you know, Sangham literature is published.
Ah.
There are literature like, you know, Akannanur. Akam means inside.
Inside.
400 poems that deal with daily life.
Published form.
Published,
now also
published,
available.
Definitely, Akannanur is published. In Tamil, it is there. In Malayalam, I don't know whether it's there. There's a Malayalam version. In English, definitely you get it.
Anyway,
you get it.
Published.
And of course, published. Published those types and republished and reprinted and versions.
It doesn't matter.
See, Bhagavad Gita is published by very many, Bible is published by very many publishers. So therefore, you know, the publication is possible. Anyone can publish. Or parts of Sangham literature is published. Anthology.
I was wondering whether the authentic reports in printed form available or not.
It's available, yeah.
For the benefit of our students.
Very much available in the net, very much available in
printed articles.
Printed articles and reference about Sangham.
Reference.
Akam 200, Akam 150, Akam 75. That's 75th poem. And clause this much. According to Akam 23 and the stanza or clause 5. This is what That's how we know. We have no authentic information other than.
So we have given a direction to our viewers also. So that is.
So that's
most
not
of them
only,
will be using this. They will be anxiously waiting for such a material.
There's not only agam. Agam is internal. There is Puranayanura, 400 poems on war, on statecraft, on diplomacy, on tussles. About the kings, this is called Puranayanura, about Puranayanura. International trade, that is Puranayanura. Whatever happening inside Tamizhagam is Aganayanura. What is happening between Tamizhagam and the rest of the world, Roman trade and trade with other parts, trade with the Marupayar Makkal, Marupayar Nadu means, you know, outside Kerala. That's Karnataka region, Gujarat region, Maharashtrian region, of course, you know, Calcutta region. So these are all called Marupayar Nadu. Marupayar trade, it's a foreign trade, is a concern of the Puranayanura. That's all. Nanur means 400. 400 poems in an anthology collection of poems. And then comes you have Padittipatta. That is also part of Sangham literature. Patti means 10.
10
poems dealing with 10 Maharajas, that is exclusively Chera. Akanayanura and Puranayanura deal with Tamil Maharajas also. That is Pandya kings, Chola kings, Pallava kings, all these. But Puranayanura, that is Padittipat, deals only with Kerala Maharajas, that is the Cheran. That is the first Cheran, Uthiyan Cheraladan. First Pat, Onnam Pat. That means, you know, one first poem out of the 10. That is lost actually.
Out of 10.
The leader or the hero in that poem is Uthiyan Cheraladan, Pirincho Tuthiyan. That is called, he is called Vanavaramban.
Vanavaramban.
That is what is called Vanavaramban. Vanam, that is heavens. Sky is the limit. You can even call it Vanavarka Anban. Vanavar means gods. Anban means friend. Anban means friend. Even Uthiyan Cheraladan. Uthiyan Cheraladan is called Perincho Tuthiyan. Perincho Tuthiyan is the king, the first Chera, major king. Second one is Nidum Cheraladan. It's called Imaya Varamban. That is Himalayam is the limit. Imaya Varamban, Vanavaramban. We learn about all these kings exclusively from Patittipat. And of course, there is something called Nattinai, Paripadan. They are all Sangham literature. And they have a grammar text also. There's a grammar book also called Tholkapiyam. Tamil is a beautiful language.
Tamil grammar.
Tamil grammar. Original, Dravidian, only Tamil. Dravidian land, everybody spoke Tamil. Tamil was a literature language. Tamil Brahmi is the written language. And spoken language is then Chenthamil and Kodun Tamil. That is all very poetic. Even now, the Tamil Nadu part of Tamizhagam now more or less uses the ancient Tamil. And Kerala part of Tamizhagam now uses a language called Malayalam. That's in Kerala.
Evolved from Tamil also.
Evolved from Tamil only with the Sanskrit influence.
This is life of a people.
Yeah.
Is always connected with the topography.
Definitely, yeah. Exactly.
What you had to say about
each land, each Thinai had a vocational group. One or two. In Kurunji, it was Vetua. Ved and Vetua. They are hunters.
They're professionally hunters.
They're professional hunters. They make a livelihood out of hunting. Hunting deer and hunting, you know, wild animals. That is the Kurunji.
Kurunji, okay? That area.
Right. Then little more down, it is the Mullai. That area is actually more of Idayas.
Shepherds.
Ayar, Idayar. Idayar. So that is, and also Kuravar. Kuram is slope.
Slope.
Slanting landscape is called Kuram. Those people who live in Kuram, that is, you know, slopes. Hill slopes, not high hills, but low hills. That's called Kuravar. And Maravas are the people in the Palayanilam. They're not hunters, they are fighters. They are dacoits.
Palayanilam.
They are bandits. Dacoits.
Burglars.
Burglars, yeah. They make a living out of confiscating wealth or amassing wealth from the Chata. Chata is Sartha Vahaka Sangham. That is a convoy, caravan.
Trade caravan.
From Chera land to Pandya land, or Chera land to Chola land, or Chola land into back into Kerala land. There are mountain passes that reach along the barren hills of the Palayanilam. They are barren hills. And when they pass along the shades of the barren hills, from the shades, they jump onto the...
Bounce upon
the caravans. And the valuable thing is basically Kalis. Kali means, you know, cattle.
Cattle.
The cattle. They just take away the cattle.
Cattle they will take
away. Yeah, the cattle. These loads were carried by cattle. They would take cattle because cattle was livestock.
Livestock.
So they take cattle. And sometimes gold and other things and valuable resources.
Along with this.
Yeah, they just steal.
Steal.
I mean, there is a war conducted by them that is called just to get cattle. That is called Vetchi. Vetchi Pore. Pore means, battle.
Fight.
And just to retrieve them. There is another warfare called Karanda. We get it from Akananur. That these kind of, you know, internal squabbles and warfare, not only from Puranananur, we get it from Akananur also. Akam poetry gives you about Vetchi and Karanda. Karanthai. These are all warfare connected with Maravas. The Maravas ultimately became the rulers. They became, you know, chieftains, they became the Chera rulers, and they are very brave people, Maravas.
And this Cheras, Cholas, Pantias.
No, before that, there is one more thing. You know, you're talking about, you know, people. See, people. not only you know, Kurunji and Mulai and Palai, the people living in the riverbed, fertile land. They are called, you know, basically Uzhava.
Uzhava.
And also Thuzhava. Thuzhavar and Uzhavar.
Uzhavar.
Uzhavar are cultivators or ploughing people, tilling people of wetland. Thuzhavar means, you know, they used to cultivate in the dry land along the riverside.
Riverside.
So dry land and wetland.
Wetland.
So they are, and there are Pulayas also. Pulam means, you know, land.
Only that much meaning.
Only land. People who owned the land, worked in the land, are called the Pulayas.
They were land owners also.
They were land owners. Everybody owned land because there was, you know, later during the time of Chaturvarnaya, people became landlords and some lost the land.
Landless people.
Landless people. So all, everybody, it was all collective ownership of the land. It was not just really owned by individuals. It was collectively owned by certain, you know, tribes.
Equal status they enjoyed.
Everybody had equal status.
Doing different kinds of jobs.
Some people are agriculturalists, you know, even come to Nidal. Nidal. These Nidal people are 3-4 different segments. One could be Meenavas. Those people who do the fishing are called the Meenavas. And Umanas are people, Umana. Umanas are people who make salt. Salt.
What?
Salt, salt.
Salt.
From
salt.
The sea water.
Oh,
salt making. They call it the Padanna. Sea water brought into land and dried up to make salt.
Salt.
And Umathiyar. Umathiyar means Umana ladies. They take the salt to far off places and sell. Along the Thinas. Different Thinas. See, the highlands don't have access to salt. From these in Nidal, they have to travel upstream. To take salt to the thing. And during barter system, they get something else from that Thina and bring it down.
They depended upon these people.
Yeah. And there was a saying called, you know, Uppum Nellum Neer Kolliro. So equal quantity of salt and equal quantity of rice exchanged in a barter system. There is an exchange between two Thinais, that is Nidal and Maritham. So these people were all there and they had their gods. They had the religious life also. They have different gods.
I was about to ask it.
Yeah. I know. Gods. That's a very interesting story, you know. That is for Kurunji. It is Ayyan.
Ayyan.
The god concept called Ayyan. Shabrimala Shasta is Ayyan.
Situated on the top of
Harihara Sudan Ayyan Ayyappa Swami Sharanam. Ayyan is a god of Thina. Kurunji Thinai.
Kurunji Thina.
That god is incorporated into the Hindu fold by Shankaracharya's Hindu revivalism, by incorporating Shaivic Hinduism, Vaishnava Hinduism, and Buddhism, Jainism, and into the original people's religion called Ayyan.
Ayyan.
And a new deity called
Ayyappan.
Ayyappan. It's Ayyan.
Ayyan.
And Shastav, Chatan also is a god of not only Mullai, and it is in Kurunji. Mullai. Chathan is a god
of the Mullai Thinai.
Mullai Thinai. That's Sabarimala is both Mullai and Kurunji.
A little bit lower.
Ayyan is also called Shastava.
The place.
Shastava is the Chathan.
Chathan. So both are same.
See, it is an inclusion. Hinduism says such a beautiful religion, incorporating all strands of, you know, people.
People.
So that's why Hinduism is called the way of life. Not just a religion, it's a way of life.
Way of life.
Incorporating all strands of, you know, human endeavors. So that is it. So they have that. And also, when you come to further down to the Maridam.
Maridam.
We have Mayon.
Mayon.
Mayon. Mayon. Mayon or Mayan.
Mayan.
That's Lord Krishna.
Oh.
Krishna worshippers were originally
Mayan. Mayan is none but Krishna.
Lord Krishna. Lord Krishna. They are Idayas.
Idayas.
There are Ayar people. You know, you heard about Ayar Kudi, Ayi Kudi, Ayi people. We have heard in another episode, we talked about Ayi.
Ayi.
Krishna's people, Yadavs.
Yadavas.
And basically the same racial stock.
Racial talk.
And they have the god Krishna. They are Jain actually. Jain is, Krishna was a devotee, is a deity. Worshipped by Jain. He is a Shalaka Purusha. In
Shalaka
Jain
Purusha.
Thing. Old, venerable people.
Venerable
gods and leaders and kings were all Shalaka Purushas. Bhagavan Ram, Lord Krishna, all Shalaka Purushas. The Jains also worship them. Hindus also worship them. So that is it. So they were
Vaishnava
sects, basically, you know. Can be said Shaiva also.
One more clarification about Cheras, Cholas, Pandyas, Sais. Their labor division, and I mean trade division. Want to hear more?
See, basically, Chera land encroached into Pandya land. Pandya land encroached into Chola land. Cholans confiscated some of the Chera land. That landscape changes. But basically, Cheras are the Maravas. Their symbol is bow and arrow. That means, you know, they are hunters and they're fighters and they are very strong.
So Cheras were burglars basically.
Only they can capture power, right? Only they can
but
capture
one thing
power.
I remember
later became they were called they were Aryanized and they were made Kshatriyas. And the Brahmins much later, 9th century.
One point you gave in a previous episode that they burglared, but not for themselves.
Redistribution of wealth to prevent amassing of wealth in the hands of one segment. If Umanas salt amass wealth, whatever, a lot of there's the paddy and rice hoarded, then other people will be starving. So if Vedas have all the control of the meat, other people won't have it.
So end justifies the means.
End justifies the means. And also the traders with all the gold, so what are they going to do with all these things?
Help the needy people.
Ensure that wealth is redistributed.
Redistributed.
Not so accumulating. Therefore Kutuvan. We are talking about, you know, the Kutuvan. We are talking about the king being a control authority in charge of distributing, redistributing wealth. So that's why
king also belonged to?
King also belonged to this.
King was the leader of these
Maravas. Leader of
these Maravas.
Maravas, yeah. Ideally, originally. But later it was Aryanized.
Chola
also were, they were basically cultivating people, Uravas and cultivating people, the riverbed. The Cholan is in, and Pandyas were fishermen. Fishermen. You know, that their symbol is fish.
They are
Meenavar and Paradavar, Meenavar and Valayar.
Pandyas.
Because they were naval powers also. They were big time naval power. And they dominated the Arabian coast and the southern Bay of Bengal coast.
That is I shepherd group.
Ah, it's a shepherd group.
Thank you, sir.
So it is very, very much gelling with all of this.
I got a very clean idea.
This way, land plays a very important role in the life, becoming the life.
Land and topography really connected with the lifestyle of the people.
Profession, trade, location.
Okay. Now it is clear.
Absolutely.
Okay. Very, thanks.
Very enjoyable time with you. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for your information. So thank you all for participating. Let us see again in the next episode. Thank you.